senior majoring in biochemistry and molecular biology and with biotechnology at Michigan State University, as you can see, green and white. So I'm here today to share my results on a yeast to hybrid analysis I did on the ACT domain, ACT-like domain of TTH transcription factor of Arabidopsis thaliana. So I'd like to start us off with the basic helix to helix transcription factors. So BHLH transcription factors are among the largest family of transcription factors in eukaryotic cells. They have the characteristic structure of a basic region that stretches about 13 basic amino acids and a HLH motif that is two amphipathic helices that are connected together with a loop. The basic region is able to bind to the EBOB sequence, which is the canonical C technology. So the CNNTG sequence, and the HLH motif is able to participate in multimerization. So the first BHLH transcription factor to be characterized in plants was the base R protein. So the N-terminus of R harbors the MIR domain, which interacts with C1 transcription factor to form a complex that regulates flavonoids, which is the interest of our lab. In the C-terminal region of R is the basic helix of helix, domain. Our lab from previous experiments also identified an ACT-like domain in the C-terminus of R. ACT domain is mostly found in enzymes, in bacteria, so it was quite interesting that we find an ACT-like domain in maize. So mutations at the ACT domain resulted in a dramatic decrease in anthocyanin accumulation in maize protoplasts, which suggests that the ACT domain participates in flavonoid biosynthesis regulation, and specifically anthocyanin biosynthesis and regulation and accumulation. So as you can see from this panel on the right, there is a dramatic decrease when we mutate the ACT. So I found this quite interesting, and we wanted to understand how exactly is this regulation. So it turns out that when the ACT domain forms a homodimer, the basic helix to helix remains in its monomeric form and is able to bind other transcription factors such as RIF1, and that complex together with C1 activates the A1 promoter. The A1 is responsible for the conversion of dihydroflavonols to leucoanthocyanins, glagolins, but concept is still the same. So when the ACT domain remains in its monomeric form, the basic helix to helix dimerizes, and that complex binds to the GBOX sequence and activates the BZ1 promoter, which is responsible for the conversion of anthocyanidins to this compound here. So this is the regulatory model that we have for the ACT domain of R. But I found this quite interesting, and I wanted to understand if this same model is followed in Arabidopsis thaliana, since as a model plant, if we can figure out the regulation in Arabidopsis, then basically we can have a model for every other higher order plant. So in Arabidopsis, we identify three orthologs of R out of about 160 basic helix to helix transcription factors in Arabidopsis. So TT8, which is transparent ester 8, EGL3, and GL3 are orthologs of R in Arabidopsis, and they're responsible for root hair formation and trichome formation as well as anthocyanin biosynthesis. So I was particularly interested in TT8 because if you work with Arabidopsis, then you will know that the phenotype of the seeds is brown, and TT8 is actually responsible for proanthocyanidin accumulation, which is the compound that accumulates in the tester. So looking at the entire C-terminal region of TT8, GL3, EGL3, and R, there's little consensus in the amino acid sequence. By looking at this general structure of the four proteins, there seems to be a very close relation in terms of their structure, and this is the predicted So the first construct shows the entire C-terminal region starting from the basic helix to helix domain all the way to the ACT domain. And then I had the ACT domain alone, which is the domain of interest. And then I also included three fragments that have the basic helix to helix. The reason for this is that basic helix to helix has to dimerize in order to bind DNA. And from previous experiments with R, we found that the basic helix to helix domain alone does not form a homodimer. But the slightly extended, which is this word over here, the slightly extended basic helix to helix is able to dimerize and bind to the G box. So it was quite interesting, and I wanted to see if this same model, this same follows in TTH. So I included three different BHNH regions. So here is my methodology. I started with a PCR to get my fragments of interest from cDNA. And then I did directional topo cloning to get my entry vectors. And followed that with the LR, the gateway cloning, to get my PAD and PBD destination vectors. So PAD and PBD work on a bait and trap mechanism. So here is how they work. If the proteins that you have on the PAD and PBD are able to interact with each other, then they form a complex that induces the expression of reported genes. In my case, it was histidine synthesis genes and adenine synthesis genes. Adenine is for the to show the strength of the interaction. So if there is interaction, histidine synthesis genes are activated. If there is a strong interaction, then also adenine synthesis genes are activated. So I transformed my PAD and PBD destination vectors into yeast and grew my yeast cells on LTH minus plates and LTHA minus plates. Leucine and tryptophan are confined in the PAD and PBD vectors. So here is a summary of my homodimerization test. So for the entire C-terminal region, there was growth on both the LTH minus plates and the LTHA minus plates, suggesting that there is homodimerization at the entire C-terminal region. So where exactly is this homodimerization happening? So the domain of interest was ACT, and as you can see, there was growth in the LTH and LTHA minus plates, suggesting homodimerization at the ACT domain as well. So, however, when it comes to the basic helix to helix regions, there was only growth in this slightly extended basic helix to helix, because as you can see, there's some growth in LTH minus plates, but there's no growth in LTHA minus plates. So this means that there is interaction at the slightly extended basic helix to helix, but it is not a strong interaction. And looking at the other regions that we had, so the basic helix to helix with the entire leucine zipper domain and the basic helix to helix alone, no growth was observed in any of the plates, suggesting no interaction. So here is a summary of my homodimerization test results. So there's a strong interaction in the entire C-terminal region and the ACT domain, and there's a weak interaction for the slightly extended basic helix to helix, and no interaction for the other two fragments. So here we could say that the homodimerization of the entire C-terminal region could be at the ACT domain. So the next step was looking at heterodimerization. So TTH, EGL3, and GL3 are transcription factors that are involved in anthocyanin biosynthesis. So there's a functional redundancy in this three transcription factors. So we suggest that they might be working together, so maybe forming homodimers or heterodimers with each other to regulate anthocyanin accumulation. So I wanted to look at the heterodimerization of these three transcription factors. And here is the heterodimerization results. So for the entire C-terminal regions of TTA, GL3, and EGL3, there was growth in both of the two plates. So as you can see, this is TTA, GL3, there was growth on both of the plates. And with the same thing with teaching an EGLP. However, when it comes to the ACT domain alone, there was no growth for both GL3 and EGL3. So, suggesting that the heterodimerization does not involve the ACT domain. However, for the slightly extended basic allelic, again, we see that there is growth in the LTH minor states, but no growth in the LTHA minor states, suggesting there is attraction, but not as strong. And that is true for GL3 as well. So this is a summary of my heterodimerization test. So there is a very strong, there's a strong interaction in the entire C-terminal region of TTA, GLP, and EGLP. And why is this interaction heterodimerization? We think that the interaction is at the slightly extended basic helix to pelvis, because as you can see, there was some weak interaction and no interaction at the ACT domain. So this led to the conclusions that the ACT domain of TTH is responsible for homodimerization in the entire C-terminal region of TTH, but TTH forms a heterodimer with GL3 and EGL3 via the slightly extended basic helix to pelvis region, which could suggest that the heterodimer is able to bind directly to DNA rather than forming, interacting with other transcription factors, like as we see when the ACT domain forms a homodimer. So the next step for this project is confirming that TTA actually follows the regulatory model that we have for R, which would shed some light on even regulation in other higher order plants. And also looking at the genes that are transcribed, the genes that are expressed by the TTA homodimers and heterodimers, as well as what happens when the ACT domain of TTA is mutated. So I would like to thank my PI, Dr. Eric Grobel, for the chance to work in his lab, and my postdoc, Sunny, who guided me throughout the whole project and who still works with me, and Bryce for inviting me here and presenting my